Good morning and welcome to the 2007 Good Friday Prayer Breakfast. We're glad that you're here. My name is Carl Gander and I'm the Area Director for the Eastern Iowa Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And it's my great pleasure to serve as your MC this morning. So why don't you turn to the person next to you and say, I'm glad you're here this morning. When Bob Klaus asked me to serve as your MC this morning, I told him that I didn't think I'd be able to do it, that I was very busy, and I told him that the bar had been set very high in previous years, and I didn't need that sort of pressure. And Bob said to me, and many of you would know Billboard Bob, he said, Carl, let me tell you a story, and I'll put it in athletic terms for you, since you're a jock. And I said, talk real slow and don't use a lot of big words. And he told me this story. He said, Carl, two zoos met in a big basketball game. Man, it was a big game. The world championship for zoos. It was the Chicago Zoo against the Sydney, Australia Zoo. And they came out for the opening tip, and sure enough, the rhinoceros from the Chicago Zoo got the basketball, and he drove right around the polar bear, and he drove left around the giraffe, and he went in for a spectacular slam dunk. And every time the rhinoceros from the Chicago Zoo got the basketball, he scored. And at halftime, he had 54 points. The Michael Jordan of zoos, Bob told me. Well, sure enough, they came out for the opening of the second half, and the rhinoceros got the basketball, and he drove right, and he drove left, and he went in for what looked like was going to be another spectacular slam dunk. And out of nowhere came an animal and blocked the shot. And for the first time in the game, the rhinoceros had been stopped. Well, the coach didn't see who made the play. Timeout, 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 he said. Who stopped the rhinoceros, the coach said. And a little voice from way down here said, I did. I stopped the rhinoceros. And the coach couldn't believe his eyes as Bob was telling me the story. The coach looked down and he saw the centipede. The centipede, he said, the smallest guy on the team, the man with 100 legs, where were you the first half? Putting on my shoes. And when Bob finished that great story, he said, Carl, the moral of the story is this. As a Christian, don't get caught putting on your shoes. Pretty good, eh? So I looked Bob in the eye, and I said, okay, you got me. I'll be the MC for this year's Good Friday Prayer Breakfast. So thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning and to be part of this great event. Today, Good Friday, we celebrate, recognize, and reflect on Jesus' death on the cross, the payment for our sin and all that that means. And it may be cold outside, but it's warm in here, and we've got a great program planned for you. And we pray that this morning will be encouraging and uplifting, and we hope inspiring. You know, some may wonder, why call it Good Friday? Why not Bad Friday? And it could well be Bad Friday, except for two things. One, as you know, it wasn't just a good man who died, but God's only Son, Jesus Christ, who died to pay the penalty for our sins on the cross. And second, the story just doesn't end on Good Friday, doesn't it? Because in 2 days, on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, and the fact that Jesus didn't just die and stay buried and dead, that he rose again, is what gives me hope, gives us hope, life, encouragement, the assurance of eternal life for each one of us who's placed our trust in Jesus Christ as Savior. I'm going to ask Bob Calhoun to come forward to open the morning. And many of you would know Bobby. He travels around the country speaking at youth rallies and churches and other events through his ministry called My Heart Cries Out for You. Great motivational speaker and a wonderful singer. And there's some more information at your tables about Bobby. And he does have some CDs available at the back as well. And Bobby is going to sing How Great Is Our God. Would you please welcome Mr. Bobby Calhoun.
Now, if you look amongst all the paperwork on your table, you'll find a little piece of white paper says, how great is our God? And of course, firsthand, we know that's true. But I would encourage you, when the chorus comes along, don't be shy, don't worry about the person next to you. Sing the song with me, how great is our God. Let's bow our hearts in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for allowing us to come together. Many denominations, many people from different walks of life. Just be here, Lord. Be here with us. We know you are. Just bless all the people here. Bless their hearts. Bless their families. In Jesus' name, amen.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the world rejoice, let all the world rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? In all we'll see, how great is our God? The God in three and one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God?
Our God.
Thank you, Bobby. Before breakfast is served, Pastor John Seitz from Antioch Christian Church will bless our meal and open the morning in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, we remember today the great sacrifice that you made on the cross 2,000 years ago. And it's with mixed emotions, Father. We praise you. You are a great God. We love you. And Father, again, it's with mixed emotions that we celebrate today because, Father, we are saddened and heartbroken that our Lord had to go to a cross to pay for our sins. But Father, we're also happy and we celebrate and we worship you because we know that he resurrected from the dead. And we have the hope, forgiveness of our sins when we trust in him. And Father, that is what we celebrate today on Good Friday. Father, we ask your blessing upon the remainder of our time together. We thank you for those who have put this event together. Father, we thank you for Star Parker being here. We thank you for all the others that are contributing to this program. But Father, most of all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray his blessing upon our meal together and on our fellowship. And all this we ask in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Breakfast will now be served, and as you begin to eat, we have some door prizes we'd like to distribute. And if you could at this time check your ticket number, and if your number is called, please just raise your hand or give us a little wave of your hand, and we'll deliver your prize out to you. We have something very special in store for you. The drum called Still Her Little Child, I'd like to introduce to you from New Covenant Bible Church, Acts of Worship.
Baby.
To acknowledge a very special guest here this morning from the great state of Kansas. Where's Senator Sam Brownback? Would you stand, please, Senator? Great to have you here this morning. Can I also refer you to page 4 of your program, if you could just open that. Very special thanks to these individuals for their special contributions this morning. Kim Miller from Antioch Christian Church, Lynn Razzo, Reverend Charles Doherty, Beth Hennessy from Hy-Vee, the Pickerings from Limestone Christian Stores, David Cowley, Becky Henderson, Scott Gasway, Dennis Spencer, Ken and Ginny Kolick from Prototype Consulting, Pro Video Incorporated, and many, many volunteers. Would you join me in thanking these folks? Page 5, and if you could read along with me as you open your program, a special thanks to our sponsors. This event would not be possible without their support. Norma Hames from Hames Homes, The Cooking Cottage, Prototype Consulting Services, Cedar Rapids Toyota, Limestone Christian Stores, David Cowley, Dental Associates of Cedar Rapids, Schumacher Carpets, Point Builders, Lynn Razzo, Banacom Signs, Antioch Christian Church, Acts of Worship, Biagi's, Maxwell Construction, Dr. Richard Noyes, Dr. Jeffrey Akey, TLC Laser Eye Centers, Lynn Farmer from Prop and Design Gallery, The Crown Plaza, Pro Video, and Lamar Outdoor Advertising, and Bob Klaus. Would you join me in thanking these folks? Well, one of the great traditions of the Good Friday Prayer Breakfast is to highlight ministries and organizations that are making an impact right here in our area and give you an opportunity to support them. And contrary to what many people might think, the Bible teaches that you don't get to heaven by doing good works or being good. In fact, in Ephesians 2:8, we read, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." And yet, God wants those who believe in Him as Savior to do good works. And in the very next verse, it says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." And so we have three very special people with us here this morning from three special organizations involved in Good Works Ministries, showing their commitment to others and making a difference in the lives of people right here in our own backyard. And we'd like to make you more aware of these ministries and give you an opportunity to support them. First, I'd like to introduce Henry Davison, the director of the HD Youth Center. Would you join me in welcoming Henry?
Good morning to all. Good morning. Let's try that again. Somebody didn't open their mouth. Good morning to all.
Good morning.
There you go. as he mentioned, my name is Henry Davis, and I'm going to make this fast because I understand I got 5 minutes or less, so I have a lot to cover. In fact, it's a 50-minute lecture, and I'm going to try to do it in less than five. That's going to be hard to do. Number one, my name is Henry, and I said, I love children. I love what I do because of the fact I am working for the Creator. Let us all say, thank you, Creator.
Thank you.
There you go. Because without Him, you wouldn't be here this morning. Believe me, He woke me up around 3:30 this morning to make sure I'm here. Now, I could have went back to sleep and I wouldn't have been here, meaning that I would have told a lie. You see, anytime you tell God you're going to do something, you need to do that. Don't forget, you need to do that. And we need help down at the youth center. And that's what we run, the youth center. Let's figure out what do the youth center do. First of all, many of you have children, or grandchildren, or great-grandchildren. Doesn't make any difference. When you at work, your children in school, when the children get out of school, you still at work. Every individual parent thinks of what is happening to my child. What is my child doing? And you begin to worry about it. If you worry too much, if you're working for someone else, I can tell you what's going to happen. You're going to make a mistake. You make too many of those, somebody else will have your job. If you know that your child came to the youth center where Henry is a non-paid, high-expensive babysitter, you don't have to worry about your child. Because of the fact, the following thing goes on. Number one, there is no drugs, no cursing, no talking about one another. The child gets something to eat. They can read the paper, or you just sit there and look up in the wall. One thing for sure, the drug man will not get to him. The drug man will not get to your child. Now, don't get me wrong. They have tried. But you see, I have a brother named Jesus Christ. He somehow or another gives me a vision when one walks in the door. Now, I can't go and tell somebody, hey, you got drugs on you, get out. But what I do is say, if you know someone that have drugs on them, coming in here with drugs, tell them the fastest way to go to jail is to come in the youth center. And believe me, they get up and leave. That have happened. The youth center have been running now for 10 years. We have tomorrow, tomorrow we're going to have an Easter egg hunt. Now, children from 0 to 12 is authorized to come out and pick up an egg. If you bring your child, do not pick up an egg. Let the kid pick it up. A reason for that, because with the plaster egg and it has a little slip of paper in there, it will say $1, $5, $10, or $20. Guess what? When a little child gets a $20 bill in his hand, and look at the smile on that child's face. And quote, mom gonna smile too. But nevertheless, there are $200 out there. So bring the children on. I don't care where you're coming from, just bring them on, okay? Now, it'd be nice for you to come with them so that you can see what goes on so next year you can keep the program going. June 2 of this year, we're going to Adventureland. We go every year. This will be the 10th year we've been. So, last year, a year before last, we took 212 children and 49 adults. Made one big mistake. We do it every year. Brought them all back. Nevertheless, it is a hard job. So somewhere along the line, you're going to get a letter asking if you want to chaperone some children. Put your name down and send the paper back, please. We need you. We feed the homeless too in the mornings. starting out at 6 o'clock in the morning to about 7:30. Let me put something through your head right quick. Never, never, never down a homeless. Because the phone could ring right now and call your name and tell you that everything you have is burned up. You're homeless at that point. I don't care how much money you have, you're homeless. And you're no better off than that person that's walking down the street with everything on his back. So don't never down a homeless. But what you can do is come down to the youth center early in the morning. How many of you going to get up at 5:30 in the morning and come down? Okay, don't put your hand up because you might tell me a lie. So, but I want you to get up, come down there Monday through Fridays. Starting at 5:30 when we start cooking it, when we open the doors at 5:45, and at 6 o'clock we put the first plate on the table. You need to help feed those people. Why? Well, one reason is they are hungry. Number two, if you feed them, they won't break in your house. Makes sense to me. I don't know about you. Because humans are human. They're going to eat somewhere. Even if they go to the store and steal a loaf of bread, somewhere along the line, the loaf of bread is going to cost a penny more than it did yesterday. So you're going to pay for it. If they break in your house and you put them in jail, you're going to have to pay for it because you're paying taxes. The tax is going to go up. Why don't you just get out of the bed and come down and feed them? All right, so much for the homeless. Now we get back to the children because we're going to have a Thanksgiving Day. First of all, we're going to have a back-to-school program. There's 5 programs all together. And if you look on your table, I think you will find a little pamphlet we call a newsletter, blue. And by the way, this is the first time it's going to be in blue. Next time it's going to be black and white. It's cheaper that way. You can't miss it because it's got my picture on it. And don't take it to the post office because they don't want it. All right, now, back to school program. Last year, we gave out 503 children school supplies. We want to do the same thing or better this year. I'm pretty sure we're going to have to because of the fact everything is going up. And the teachers and the principals and so forth, they want the children to have different kinds of stuff, up-to-date equipment, because the factories are making it. And therefore, we're going to have to give it out to them. Otherwise, the kids going to get talked about if they have something that don't look up-to-date. So I say to you, think about it. Help the youth and help your children. Then we have Thanksgiving and Christmas. We have to take care of Thanksgiving and Christmas. We give you frozen turkey or frozen ham ahead of the holidays so that you can have the turkey on the table for that holiday. We gave out 20-some turkeys last year frozen, 20-some hams. We hope to do better this year. Someone's going to ask the question of how are we funded? I like this one. If you let this pen map with your checkbook and you send it to the youth center, that's how we get funded because we're not selling anything there. Your donation is how we get it. Please remember that when you get ready to buy something you don't need. And we all do that every once in a while. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to say to the good Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Say it now loud and clear.
Thank you, Jesus.
And thank you for letting me be here. Bye.
Thanks, Henry. Next will be P.J. Swentick from the Christian Motorcyclists Association. Let's welcome P.J.
Well, Well, good morning, everybody. How do you like my Sunday go-to-meeting clothes? Hold on just one second. I have to do something here. Thank you. Folks, what's in the center is what it's all about. And that's doing whatever you do is unto the Lord. And that's part of what CMA is all about. Back in the 1970s, a pastor from Arkansas was trying to rebuild a relationship with his son. They were kind of growing apart. So he got a couple motorcycles, and they went out into the highways and byways, and they started seeing a need in the motorcycle community. Now, Pastor Shreve, of course, is one of those guys, saw the need. He's busy in a church, and he says, God, you know, you've got to send somebody out here to meet these needs. I mean, there's needs everywhere I go. You've got to send the right person out here. God, I know you've got somebody going to touch their heart. Well, as most of you know, if you see the need, you're the one God is going to send. So he left his church. He started and created the Christian Motorcyclists Association in 1975. And so what has happened now, you have people that have gone to service out into the highways and byways to show the love of Christ. And we are now in 26 different countries. We have over 138,000 members. And part of what we do is we are servants. We are invited to go to rallies and different events, churches. Part of what we do is we do bathroom cleaning. We pick up trash. We give out free coffee and free water. We have a first aid station. We'll do security, take gate receipts. But what happens is during this process, we start building trusting relationships. We do what we call earn the right to speak at these different assemblies. And what happens, that opens the door to personal ministry. Because you see, folks, when God sets up a divine appointment for you, and he wants you to speak to somebody, after you've spoken to them, you don't know what's going to happen to them. And we know from personal experience, some of the people that we have ministered to and led to Christ were taken home very shortly after they left. So it behooves us, you know, to be there, be available. CMA ministers to the motorcycle community, which is an aspect that the general church at large does not go to. You know, let's face it, when you start seeing people wearing leathers and so on coming at you, you're thinking a very negative thought. You know, put your daughters away, you know, hide your wallets and your purses. But folks, the thing that we share is a love for motorcycling. And because of that, we're able to go into that area and touch people. We go into darkness. And these dark areas require tremendous prayer covering. So I'm going to tell you right up front, we covered your prayers. And one of the things that we do also is we able to have church, little church services at some of these events because we've earned that right and let us to go in there and do that. Now CMA members are servants from all different types of churches. This is you have here this morning. You notice different denominations, non-denominations, they all come together for one goal. And CMA members are encouraged to participate in their local church. They are encouraged to pay their tithes at the body where they're fed. But you know, we are supported by individuals as us, different ministry groups, and we do a once a year fundraiser that's called Run for the Sun. And what that is done is a motorcycle ride that is set up, a 100-mile ride, and we get sponsors. And the sponsors can make a one-time donation, they can make a per-mile pledge, whatever they want to do. Now those monies are split up. 60% goes to three different ministries. You have Open Doors. How many of you know of Open Doors Bibles? They get in places where nobody else can get Bibles in this world. We have Missionary Ventures, which allows CMA to get a motorcycle or another mode of transportation necessary for pastors in other countries that are out in rural areas, jungles, where they just can't drive. And to walk to get to these other villages would take days. This enables them also to spend more time at home with their families. Another one is the Jesus Film Project. How many of you heard of that? Okay, that's another supporter that we do. And they are also, this time, working on a new movie, and it's about the three Marys in the Bible. And this is directed towards Muslim women. So this is something that can be very dangerous for these women, so I'm asking you now to keep that in your prayers as that goes forth. Our chapter president, Roger Bush, and his wife, Lori Bush, have been spending a number of years building up a relationship with a motorcycle club that sponsors Conesville events. Now, this club out there that they work with does a lot of fundraising through their events, and they give back tremendously to the community all the time in very special ways. Lori Bush also does speaking at women's events, and Roger will be one of the ones that holds a church service at some of the rallies. John Pogenpole is an award recipient last year of Governor Bill Sachs' Prison Volunteer of the Year. He goes to three different prisons, Fort Madison, Anamosa, and Mount Pleasant, weekly. He holds Bible studies and church services. Now, he doesn't get paid for this. This is a volunteer thing that we all do. So we just want you to know that. And many people have come to the Lord because of his faithfulness in doing this service. Another member is Bob Vasek. Now, he works for the University of Iowa Hospitals there in Iowa City. And what he has started is a down biker visitation program. A lot of times, bikers going on rallies, traveling interstate, if there's an accident, they might be far away from home and their family members. We get permission, we get permission to go in and visit that down biker. You know, we go in, if we do nothing else but sit with them. If they allow us to pray with them, we do. If they need, the family member comes and needs transportation, we provide that. If necessary, might be short-term housing while they're in the hospital. Mike Williams is here today also, and he works with Mission of Hope up on First Avenue. And he works in many different areas. He's on staff now, so he works with Bible studies, worship. He's also working with the team that renovates a resident house for people, for a shelter. Believer Bill Iowa is here. He is our chaplain for this chapter this year called Knights for Christ. And he works at the Father's House, and he's got set up a really great program. I'm sure some of you have heard it. It's called Celebrate Recovery. Now, he does this on Friday nights at 6 o'clock. Don Swentick and I, we work with Angel Food Ministries. We go on hospital visits, and we serve in different capacities at some of the rallying events. We placed some information here out on your tables. This is some of the different types of ministry tools that we do have. If you'll notice, some of you see a grease rag, but it's really a rag tract, and inside is information that would lead a biker or somebody that's mechanically inclined, you know, into the idea of coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ. We try to use terminology that people are familiar with and become associated with very quickly. There's tracks there regarding, you know, for women, for youth, those that go into the fast bikes, you know, for the racing. And one of the things I wanted to show you is, this is a new track. I don't even think they're out on the tables yet, but it's titled No Fear. And inside it talks about having respect for the Lord, fear of the Lord God, our Creator. But also, when I think of this, the Bible talks many times about fear not. You see, if God is for us, who can be against us in every situation? And so we have been blessed to be able to go and truly make a difference. There are also some informational brochures if you'd like to know more about CMA, or if you happen to know people that ride. What better way to connect maybe a young person that likes to ride, that loves Christ, and doesn't know how to connect it as a ministry? Here is a tremendous opportunity. We have 10 different types of what you call serving positions through CMA that we are trained for and we make a one-year commitment to. We've got a prison ministry, we have mechanical, we have women's, we have youth, first aid, we have children, prayer, and prison ministries. You know, these are many different ways to get involved. And we try to go out as couples if possible. We have a lot of single people. And sometimes a spouse doesn't feel comfortable going into some of the areas we do. But you know what? That spouse can pray. Because we need prayer continually to go into the dark areas that we go into and dealing with really some of the evil that is out there in this world. So I just want to thank you this morning. We have Run for the Sun sponsorship forms out there on some of the tables. If you're interested in sponsoring one of the members for Run for the Sun, please fill that out. Talk to any one of the CMA members. We're kind of spread all around here this morning. And thank you.
You want your
coat back, PJ? It won't fit me. Thank you, PJ. And lastly, would you welcome the Executive Director of Youth for Christ, Mr. Buzzy Castingay?
Thank you, Carol. Well, once again, good morning to you. We are Youth for Christ. Youth for Christ is an international organization. And basically what we do is we try, our mission is to reach every kid everywhere. And that takes on a lot of different formats. But really, that comes down to the thing I learned from working with kids for over 20 years, is it doesn't matter where they're at, it doesn't matter their socioeconomic background, it doesn't matter their skin color, it doesn't matter if they're involved in certain activities or not involved in certain activities, the bottom line is every kid has a heart. And Jesus Christ wants that heart. And that's what we're all about, is we're about reaching those kids for Jesus Christ. We do that in a number of ways. One of them, basically, is our campus ministries. And we try and get on campus, the public school campuses, Christian school campuses, anywhere kids are. And basically, we try and build a bridge, because there's a lot of kids on those campuses. And there's a lot of kids in churches, but there's not near as many kids in the churches as there are on those campuses. And what we try and do is be the bridge to where we can build a relationship with those kids, and we can share Christ with them, and basically just be a friend to them, and show them, you know what, somebody cares. Let me tell you a story I heard just yesterday, actually. One of our people was talking to somebody, a young person, and they were just talking about this weekend and, you know, being Easter and everything. And this girl, who normally does not go to church, said she might go to a very different kind of church, not a basic Bible-believing church like you and I would know. And this person says to her, well, you know, you're more than welcome to come to church with me. I'd love to have you go to church. And she said, oh, well, you go to one of those Christian churches that teaches about Jesus, right? And she said, yeah. And the girl said, no way, not for me. Now, isn't that a sad statement of where our culture is today? And you know what? That's why we do what we do. It's because now we know that we want to build a relationship with that girl. And we want to build a relationship with her so that she'll trust us. And that one day, she might come to church with us. And she might know about the Lord that loves her. But for some reason, whatever it might be, she is not going to go to church by herself right now. And so that's why we're there. We try and build that bridge and be there. How do we do that? We do that in a number of different ways. We've got the campus ministries. We've got camp ministries. We take many, many kids to camp, a couple different camps every summer. And there's great life-changing experiences that happen at those camps. Some of those kids pay, if anything, hardly anything to go to those camps. We try and raise all the money to take them to that. There's camps in Colorado. There's camps down in Missouri. There's many different types of camps that we do that. And lastly, you. How can you get involved? What's your role? Number one, we too, just like these ministries here, we cover your prayers. Because we know that nothing's going to happen without seeking God first. And so we would ask that you pray with us and for us. You've got a sheet there on your table, talks a little bit about what we're doing this summer and these things. And just pray for the ministry. We would cover that. If you're interested in kids and in youth and you want to volunteer with us, we've got plenty of openings, plenty of ways to use you and partner with you and help and have you help the ministry. We'd love for you to do that. And then lastly, if you're interested in helping us out financially, again, the address and phone number and all that is on there. We'd love to talk to you about that, talk to you about the different opportunities, and tell you about what God's doing. Because you know what? When God changes one of those hearts, and you see a young person turn from their ways to God's ways, people have nothing better than that. And that's what Youth for Christ is all about. Thanks for letting us be here this morning.
Thanks, Buzzy. Three terrific ministries. Perhaps you're motivated and excited to contribute to one, or maybe all of these great ministries. You'll notice an opportunities for support sheet at your table. I believe they're in baskets there. And if you'd like to support one of these three wonderful ministries, please designate that clearly on that card. And there's some envelopes in the baskets as well. And place those back in the baskets, and we'll collect those afterwards. So thank you again to Henry and PJ and Buzzy for your willingness to share with us this morning. We're going to have Michaela Fisher introduce our guest speaker here in just a moment, but she's got something special she's going to share with us before she does that. Michaela's a senior at Washington High School, and we've got a Washington High School fan there. And many of you would know she's a standout athlete in basketball and track and field. She told me she's going to break my sister's 25-year-old high jump record this spring, right? You're going to do it. I'm pulling for you. And she's going to introduce our guest speaker. But before she does that, she's going to share with us this morning a faith wrap. Now, that's not a sandwich. A faith wrap. So turn to the person next to you and say, get ready, we're going to hear a faith rap. And also there's a sheet on the table that you can follow along and read as well. Would you please welcome Michaela Fisher.
I'd just like to preface that I wrote this for my confirmation class, and that's all it started out as, and I didn't realize that I'd be sharing it with a bunch of people, so I'm glad that I can. My name is Michaela Fisher, and I go to First United Methodist Church in North Liberty. This is my statement of faith, and I'm excited to wrap it to all of you from me. Hold up, wait a minute, let me put Jesus in it. Back when I was 2, I was baptized, but it wasn't long ago when I realized that Jesus, my one and only Savior and King, had thought of me before I ever was saved. Now, not only was he thinking about me, but he wanted a close relationship, you see, where I can talk to him and he can talk to me, where I can listen to him and he will protect me. You hear it all about in Psalm 23. Let's take it back to the beginning, there is nothing in sight. And then God said, hey, I want some light. He created night and day and night, and all of our surroundings that are now in sight. Next came Adam and Eve, whom were made in God's image in the Garden of Eden. There was a scrimmage with a snake and an apple that brought Eve in to take one fateful bite that created all sin. Now let's jump ahead to 0 AD when Jesus was born, which is pretty key because he brings in 1/3 of the Trinity, which is pretty important to Christianity. We've got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, you see, which wouldn't be complete without these three. Now going back to the Garden of Eden again, where Eve's one bite gave sin its begin. I'm sure the snake felt satisfaction knowing that his cunning led to the resurrection. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, there began a tradition that has always stayed, where he broke the bread and said, here, take, eat. This is my body. Including his feet. Eat this in remembrance of me. And then he took the wine so solemnly and said, this is my blood shed for you. He knew he was their favorite Jew. Drink this in remembrance of me. And they said, oh, so peacefully. This meal known as the Last Supper is repeating Pastor Alicia stands up there saying these words to the rest of us. Partake if you are able, it is not a must. On a night that Jesus' cheek, I'm sure he would not sleep for a week, carrying a crown made of thorns, running across to the crowd, enduring horrid words that were awful loud, staying strong through our stream and made the Father proud. And so Jesus was taken to Calvary and nailed to the cross for all to see. Give redemption to you and me. Check it out in John 3:16. And so Jesus rose to join the big guy, whose kingdom is up there in the sky, watching over you and I. See you soon. Sayonara. Adios. Bye-bye. And so we were given many spiritual gifts, as well as eternal life and forgiveness. But forgiveness only comes when we forgive ourselves, because his love for us cannot be held on shelves. Now I know I've wrapped on longer than I should, but I've got to talk about servanthood. I owe it to the big JC. After all, his death sanctified me. I was made holy and freed from sin. So when I knock on the door, God will let me in. I will go to church, read, write, learn, and pray, and give myself each and every day. I will remain pure and tell the truth. Wow, that is a lot for youth. But if that is what I've got to do, as well as have a personal relationship with you, I will do it all. Yep, it's true. So that's my plan, 24/7, and to follow Ephesians 6:10 through 11 till the day I join my guide in heaven. She was a single mother on welfare in L.A. After receiving Christ, she returned to school for CWS and started something cool. She launched a magazine for the Christian cause. Outstanding, yes. Please hold your applause. This woman gives testimony regularly in front of the U.S. Congress and commentating on TV. Between CNN and MSNBC, she's defended welfare reform on Oprah Winfrey. From welfare fraud to conservative crusader, her transformation is food for the digest reader. From the Wall Street Journal to the Washington Post, her articles and quotes deserve a toast. Coalition on Urban Renewal and Education is a national voice of reason type of organization. With inner city issues, race, and poverty, CURE helps with the public policy. I am here today to introduce a phenomenal woman, a role model for youth. With the inspiration from Christ and our God's grace, she can put a smile on a helpless face. Ladies and gentlemen, the founder and president of the Coalition on Urban Renewal and Education, Star Parker.
I've not heard my bio rap before. But you know what this podium reminds me of? A lot of folks say that, they say it very negatively, that Sunday morning is the most segregated hour in America. And I have to let them know that actually Sunday morning is the most integrated hour in the world, because you have with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, various people from various backgrounds praising and worshiping the Lord in their personal expressions. I mean, we have a biker and a rapper. Denominational church, and then my dearest friend, I have to acknowledge, in Washington, D.C., one of my dearest friends. 2 months ago, I moved my entire operation to Washington, D.C., and my bishop reminded me to remember that Potomac is poison, not perfume. But in Washington, D.C., there are some politicians that are statesmen, and when I heard that one of my friends was going to be here, Senator Brownback from Kansas, you know, it's enough that we're in Iowa. We as Christian folks have very few there, and he just happens to be one of those few statesmen. And you know, I was thinking, but what is he doing in Iowa? And then I remember, oh yeah, Iowa. It's a political year. And then I had to ask myself, well, why am I going to Iowa? I am not a politician. And I've been told, don't political, but I have been, because my life is political, but I'm certainly not a politician. And in fact, I promised the Lord when he saved me that I would not go back into the theft business. I used to be Friday morning, because it is such good news. And when you think about charity, why I'm in Washington, D.C., I started on this journey and have landed there. But the journey was not a political journey. It was a moral journey. Because it's about charity. It's about the poor. And when I think about all of the issues that we are told today are political issues, the criminal activity that I'd gotten involved in is politics today. The drug addiction that I was involved in is politics today. The sexual promiscuity that landed me in and out of abortion clinic after clinic. I mean, I finally had a gut instinct way down deep inside that there has to be something wrong with killing your offspring. Maybe the feminists are wrong on this one. See, I bought the lie of the left. I mean, I coupled not only moral relativism, this message in our society today that we own ourselves. We're the arbiter. We can do whatever we want to. It's all relative. Situational ethics. You couple that with this welfare state mentality, that any natural consequences that might come from the choices that you're making in your life, you don't have to worry about anymore because we've got safety nets. You couple those two messages together, and people can get very lost in our society today. And they're getting lost in record numbers now. I mean, I'm talking, only my hairdresser knows for sure exactly how old I am, but when I was doing these types of activities, we were like in the 70s. Fast forward to today, like into the milk carton, what has happened in our society. The milk carton that now you want to put water into. Use it to feed your garden. First couple of times that you put water in it, there's still a little bit of milk residue. But by the third rinsing, it's gone. It's all water. If you start thinking about God's message of morality, it's easy for people to get lost. He laid down the rule books, and he said, this is what you do. And then he said it. King Solomon told us, don't move those ancient landmarks. In fact,
The psalm, the proverb says it more than once, twice, I believe. Pastor, you have to correct me if you did it three times. Maybe I've missed it. But he said you can't remove these landmarks because people need to know what to do. It's the most amazing thing that has happened in a society and in our world. In every other discipline, we know that there are rules to govern those disciplines. I mean, think about it. You think about science. There are rules that govern science. Engineering. I fly a lot. There are rules that govern engineering. Medicine. I recently hurt my knee. Went to the doctor. Now, most of us don't notice what, you know, certificate our doctors have on their wall, what school they went to. That's their business. And, you know, they paid all that money to get to medical school. We're glad they're there. But when they say you might need surgery, all of a sudden you look at that certificate a little bit closer. So, doctor, I noticed you went down here to University of Iowa. I didn't go to University of Iowa. I printed that at Kinko's. You might have to excuse yourself. All of a sudden, he might not be qualified to start cutting on your knee or your brain. There are rules in every discipline in our society. There are rules in math. A lot of people think that they don't like math. In fact, they're doing major studies now. What's the big thing about these political issues? A whole lot of folks sitting out there, huh, saying, talking about studying this and that and the other. There's a whole lot of studies going on right now. So one particular study that was discussed in Forbes magazine recently talked about just the diminishing of the idea of the concepts of mathematics and how there are just not people going into math anymore. Who's going to learn these rules? I said, well, actually, math rules are kind of birthed inside of us, especially as women. You put something on a 33% off sale and we can figure that out. They come in the house and, oh, yeah, no, it was on sale and I got it for X amount. Well, we know math. There are rules that govern everything. There are rules that govern even rap. I mean, we can't all get up there singing. How great is our God? Now, I'm supposed to run in my race, but I'll talk to the Lord about that later. I can't sing. There are rules to this. There are rules to music. Even art. You cannot change the primary colors of art. Now, there are those that attempt to. I was just recently in New York City at a museum, and they had a piece of glass against a wall, and they named the artwork Glass Against the Wall. There were people actually walking by there looking at it like it had some type of expression. This is so much for New York and you think the crazies are in LA, huh? But when it comes to life, all of a sudden people can figure out what to do. We don't need the rules anymore. It's all relative. So what happens now in a society where you have this brokenness and despair? What happens in a society to where you have out-of-wedlock birth rates that are escalating and people get their information on how to self-govern, this first step out of poverty, how to self-govern? They get that information by looking outside and seeing what everybody else is doing. Because without instruction, what else are they to do? You get an invitation to go to a party, and what do? You call your girlfriend and see what she's wearing to that party, because they didn't say what to wear. You know, obviously this one is diverse. He didn't put the instruction on what to wear. So we all get to choose on our own. Now we have an invitation to live, to be human beings, civil to one another. People forget what to do. They look outside and see, well, what should I do? And they see pop culture. Then we send them these cesspools that we call schools. Oops, that's political. And what do they hear? Secular humanism. Then you go out in the workforce, and what are we to do? Live morally relative. It's all politically correct. I'm okay, you're okay. Yeah, it was easy for me to get lost. I was self-destructing. After that gut instinct way down deep inside, I knew I wasn't going into that abortion clinic again. That was after the fourth time I had visited their so-called safe, legal, rare clinic. And I hadn't changed any of my behavior patterns. I mean, I didn't know the rules over sexuality. Oh, you hear about it. It seems like it should be a good idea. And when you start out at 2 and 3 and 5 years old and you think about what it is you want to do with your life, you're not thinking that I want to just go out and just be promiscuous. You know, most women have that little Cinderella dream in her little heart. And I was pregnant again within a very short period of time. This time I was kind of proud of myself, Pastor, because I could at least narrow down to two who the father of the kid was. And I looked at my income options, and the most viable for my life at that point was to go into the welfare state. Because I was already familiar with it. We're bought into this concept as a society that there is nothing wrong with redistribution of wealth. And a whole lot of Christian folks thought that maybe this is the best way to deal with charity. You send my little money off somewhere else so that I don't have to think about it. Like George Gilder argues in Men in Marriage. He says, you know, we thought we were helping. Maybe, you know, there are those that are despair. Maybe we can't touch their lives. So we'll send a little bit of money for them to get their little housing, to get their little food, to get their little subsidy. He said, but we were wrong. Because we removed God from that equation. And we start thinking about it. Now, I'm looking at my life and what am I going to do now? I was very familiar. In fact, when I was pregnant, you know, before abortion, it was the state. He send you the check on the 1st and the 15th of the month, so you just stay pregnant as long as you want to. As long as you can stand it. It's all choice. Choice loses its meaning if it doesn't matter what you choose. But that's all we hear in Washington, D.C., is it's choice. So you stay pregnant as long as you can, then you go kill the kid. So I was already very familiar with the welfare state, and I couldn't go back home. I had burned all the bridges back there. There are house rules. That society says we don't have to live with it anymore. In fact, we tell our 14, 15, 16-year-olds that they don't have to live with it anymore. In fact, my 12-year-olds in California don't have to live with those rules anymore. You just say, I'm out of here, and they go to the state. Like R.C. Sproul said, the state, you know, the problem with statism, it's a philosophy of government. That not only is the state the final authority, it's the ultimate agent of redemption. You have a problem with that, huh, Pastor, with the collar? See, we still have symbols in our society. We can tell that there's a problem with the state being the ultimate agent of redemption. But this is the society that we've built for ourselves. So I was very familiar with this environment. I didn't have to listen there. I certainly wasn't going to go get a job. What are you kidding? Main Street? I bought that lie, too. America is inherently racist. I am not about to go get a job. The real truth of the matter was I didn't like time clocks. I was so rebellious that I was doing whatever I wanted to do and no one would tell me when to be somewhere. Marriage, the feminists had wrapped that one up. They said it was Victorian. Of course, I didn't know what that meant. They said it was like prostitution. Well, that sounded like a party. But when they said it was like slavery, I thought, well, no, we're on gold hour out. What are your income options then? The welfare state. For the next 3.5 years, I watched my life go into a little black hole. I didn't even know it was in a hole. I thought I was living large. How many of you saw The Lion King? Remember little kid, little Simba? Little Simba was a king's kid. But he lost his way. Now he's out in there playing Hakuna Matata. He actually thought he was doing something. I'm just having a big party. And I was having a big party. My life from circling out of control. But see, God has an ultimate plan. That's one of the beautiful things about Good Friday and charity and what his ultimate plan for his son and for all of his children. He knows what he can do. And I'm telling you, when he begins the journey for somebody to discover it, he doesn't stop. So I'm thinking that I'm all right. I mean, why wasn't I all right? I was getting my little check on the 1st and the 15th. I got my little Medicaid card. I got my little food stamp. It wasn't always enough, though. So you look to subsidize your little income and, you know, go and get some under-the-table cash if you could. Something you didn't have to tell the state because Uncle Sam was a hard taskmaster. His rules are don't work, don't save, and don't get married, and we'll keep you enslaved to us. We have over 4,000 housing projects across this country. You know, it upsets me when I think about God's people and how distant we are now from what has occurred with the investment that he has given us with our jewels, with our treasures. And we start thinking about how Uncle Sam has interpreted his plan for poor people's lives very differently than what God said. You know, when Jesus was confronted with hunger, he didn't say, send them to the Department of Social Services so they get some food stamps. And he had a whole lot of times. I mean, there are hundreds, thousands of them. And why they, oh, no, send them out. Get some food stamps. And he said, bring them to me. And the disciples said, what, bring me? Yeah, you feed them then. So anyway, we decided that we were going to take a different route. But it's a hard taskmaster, so you kind of look to get your little income subsidized. So I was looking to get my little income subsidized, and I went into a place of business in South Central L.A. And I was expecting them to pay under the table. It was just common. A whole lot of small business people can't operate under this new structure of government either. Very cruel, Uncle Sam, to some of our smaller businesses. So when they want to take on, you know, people, it's hard. So, you know, why do you think we have a political issue? The immigration situation we have now. To a little under the table. So I walked in this place to get paid reason I pointed they were good looking because I wanted to work there. I mean, my normal day was hanging out at Venice Beach, getting high all day, partying all night. And I thought, man, if these guys will hire me, I could party all day, but with them. And they were like, oh, we don't pay like that. Actually, you wouldn't even be able to work here. They go, wait a minute, how come you don't pay like that? You know some brothers? Well, we're mainstream. Mainstream? What black mainstreams in this society? Don't you know Jesse Jackson? You're not supposed to do that. America's inherently racist. I said, you know, you wouldn't be able to work here anyway. I mean, this is just not going to work. Why couldn't I work here? Your lifestyle. What's wrong with my lifestyle? It's unacceptable. Unacceptable? That's a hate crime. You can't say that word in today's society. That's politically incorrect. Unacceptable to who? They said, God. I got chills and got out of there. I know, I wish I could tell you I fell down and got saved. No, I got the Baptist guilt. I got out the door. I started thinking about it. No, I'm like, God, like with a capital G, God, where's he been? I'm thinking about the breaking and entering, the armed robbery. My goodness, the things I had done when I wrote my autobiography. There's a lot mentioned missing out of that book because I don't know about statutes of limitations. And I lived in a state where we put Tippi Williams to sleep and made national news. Y'all might be familiar with it because they were trying to say that he had been redeemed and he didn't need to be executed, although he did the crime. And I was up all night because I was thinking about all during that same time that he was doing his crime, I was living that criminal life as well. And God revealed to me about 2 o'clock in the morning about his justice. He said, there are two sides to my scales of justice, judgment and mercy. He had mercy on me. I'm getting out of that place. And the brothers, they kept calling me up, though, because I'd already filled out the little application, so they're calling me up trying to get me to go to church with them. I tell you, Christians, man, if I'd known a lawyer from the ACLU, I would have sued him for religious harassment. I didn't know any lawyers then. I hang out with a lot of lawyers now in Washington, D.C., and boy, they remind me of the people I used to hang out in the street corner with. Sam, I'll tell you, this man's got a lot of patience because I don't know how you do it. I would not be able to. I would be in jail because I'd have to slap somebody by now. Sitting up there talking out of turn with on God. Telling us that there's a wall of separation between church and state. You separate the church, you've just separated a people from their core. Because I'm telling you, one day I went to the church with those brothers just to get them off my back. And the gospel was preached. Is there power in the gospel? Yeah. I'm telling you, there was so much power in that gospel, I didn't know what I was getting saved to or from, but I was down on my face when that man said, do you want Christ? The rules. Here's what you do. How dare somebody tell me that it's chains? Heard a debate last night about the homosexuals. Political. You said, don't do. You know, I've been studying lately Psalm 41. It starts out and talks about just the joys of those who are kind to the poor. It says it'll protect them. Oh my goodness. That's protection. You said it would keep them alive. The do book. I start doing everything that little preacher said to do. And see, once the journey begins, see, the problem with what we're trying to do in Charity Washington, D.C. is we think that we can figure things out for people's lives. We think that poverty is a scientific equation and that there's a technical answer to this question. And yet it's not. One of the reasons that the welfare said, well, there are two that doesn't work. One of the reasons it doesn't work is because we're talking individual people and individual lives. Pain is unique. So you're talking about you had a youth center right there. Every one of those little kids, they have a different story. They're individuals. It's really personal. So you can't have a one-size-fits-all solution. What we have to have is you, decent people in quiet communities doing amazing work for God. That's the only way that we can reach those in need. We just want them to turn it down when they're running through our neighborhood. and welfare state doesn't work is because it's inconsistent with the scripture. The whole concept of redistribution of wealth violates the 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet. I mean, think about it. Socialism is rooted in covetousness. It's the politics of envy. Somebody has something somebody else doesn't have, so we're going to hire a policeman to go and take it from them. That's what law is. It's force. The police will come to your door if you do not pay your taxes. It's another violation. There's another commandment that says don't steal. They want to do charity, but we don't get letters from the IRS to say, would you like to graciously give to this Now, the Lord continues the journey. When he was ready, you got a list of 10. He had to keep me from doing the activities I was doing. Tell him, my little kid, don't open the door, don't answer the phone, I'll be right back. He's barely old enough to open the door and answer the phone. I might come back in the house at 2 o'clock in the morning, some strange man. He had a lot of other things to work on in my life before he got down to the economic situation that I had placed myself in. But he was ready to do that one day. That pastor looked at 4,000 people and pointed his finger and said, what are you doing living on welfare? I said, what? How does he know I live on welfare? I cleaned up then. You know, some of us look good to go to church, but hurting way down deep inside. See, that's poverty. That's why poverty is so personal. You got to look at people's eyes. We don't want to be bothered, but we got stuff to do, places to go. So I'd rather just send it off, just get mad when it became a lot. Just don't let it come my neighborhood. And, he looked out and he said, why are you living on welfare? I thought those brothers told on me. I'm thinking, wait a minute now. I'm doing everything this man said about my money. He said to tithe, I was tithing. He said to give, I was giving. In fact, I gave him food stamps once. They sent them back. They sent the church and take them. See, God already had an economic plan for poverty. He told us to tithe. He said, there needs to be meat in my house. There has to be food there. Jesus was very clear on the day of his reading. He opened the scripture and it just happened to be from Isaiah. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. They're out there trying to pass a law. But you can't, what they call proselytize. He will give you a little bit of money. The devil never changes his strategy. We'll give you a little money, but don't you tell anybody the good news. There's a reason he wanted the gospel preached to the poor. Because there are two factors in the gospel that are so necessary to help people. One, he said, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. It's how we know what to do. Amen. And some folks really do not. And I know it's hard to comprehend for people that just like everything just worked for them. Because the family passed down tradition. But when tradition gets broken, when family gets broken, and the reason we see in the inner city in such chaos and turmoil today is because those families got broken the fastest. Because they were in a total lack of despair. Black community was hurting in the 60s when they started the social engineering. But I'm going to tell you, in worse situations of racism and poverty, our families stayed intact. Up until the latest 65, 78% of black husbands were in their homes with their wives, raising their children. So that's why this new phenomenon of crime and drug activity is difficult. Because it's new. People were able to keep their communities intact and clean. But as soon as that family started breaking down, because this governmental promise that we'll take care of you, left a message to poor men that the best thing they can do for a poor woman is leave her with a baby. And next thing you know, family life is broken down. And all of a sudden, we have despair. And in black America, we got 7 out of 10 babies born outside of marriage. We have 500,000 kids in our foster system. They're not 500,000 Christians in this society? What in the world are we doing with the foster system? Where they have a number on their head. This is what we've done. What a cause of poverty. We said the gospel's revealed, but there's something else about the gospel. Not only the righteousness of God being revealed in it, it changes people's lives. The message of the gospel is very simple. God is in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting our sin against us. He loves us. He died for us. He's not mad at us. He redeemed us. And this is what people have to know. So that as they begin the first step out of poverty to self-govern, he'll continue the movement in their lives. That preacher said, is God or government? I'm thinking, God or government? said, and my God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And I started thinking about that preacher's God supplying my need. You know, I know that this is political too. There's great discussion now about whether we should have symbols in our society. I mean, you can't have the Ten Commandments in the school anymore because those kids might read it and stop killing each other. Oh, how dare us with the scriptures that they want the scriptures off of the at the Grand Canyon now. You can't have those little songs there. People might think about them. Might change their life. They got a cross up in San Diego near where I live. 60 years that cross has been on that prop. No, you got to take that down. Can't have those symbols in anymore. I don't know what they're going to do about Washington, D.C., because those symbols are everywhere. In fact, you go in that Senate chamber, and all the philosophers of the world are up there, and their little heads are turned to the side, except one, Moses, looking right at those liars. I bet you we do some research and investigation, we're going to find out that they're really behind this political movement to remove all of these. I'm wondering how much the ACLU gives each and every one of them on both sides of the aisle. The people from American Way and all the rest of those guys that don't think God should be in our presence anymore. But I'm telling you something, they can't take his symbols away. They're certainly not going to take the pastor collar off, the priest collar off. And they certainly can't do anything about the God I saw yesterday when I flew up from Southern California to your cold weather. Because you get up over those clouds and all of a sudden you see him. I'm telling you, fly from Southern California where I live and you get above the clouds and the mountains are still sticking through, it gives you chills. You get out here and you just see the flat land drawn out in little squares. I do. And you can understand why the psalmist and how he wrote, when I just consider the heavens, the work of his fingers, the moon and the stars that he's ordained. But you compare that God to this $430 and a couple of $100 worth of food stamps and a Medicare card. I mean, that's not rocket science. I wrote my caseworker and told her, take my name off. I'm trusting the Lord. Well, she didn't clap. There's an indoctrination going on in the social services department, I suppose, because she was pretty upset with me. Yeah, let's see. So I didn't have pardonable sin. I didn't send my CA7 back. It might be called an IO7 out here, or IW7, or whatever. It's that form. Make sure you're 4. Make sure nobody went to school, nobody died, nobody turned 18, nobody went to work. Nobody got married. So Uncle Sam can stay the head of that household. I didn't send the form back. You don't send the form back, you're not getting a check. And I had to really trust the Lord. Because he didn't grow a money tree in my yard either. But in my yard, what am I talking about? I had no sense of ownership. But I knew some things. I knew one thing is I got better go get a job. I don't want to go too much time, but I'm just telling you it's a simple story. My life was a political story. Because I could see the difference. I had to get a job, and I had listened to the lies of them. The people that represent my interest in Washington, D.C., that wear the same color skin that I wear, and they had told me all my life that white people won't hire black people unless the government makes them. I could hear it in the back of my mind going in there. White people don't hire black people unless the government makes them. I saw a little bitty white guy. I'm like, if he don't hire me, I'm going to beat him up because I need a job. And that little man was one of the quiet people in quiet communities doing quiet work. He hired me. He wasn't thinking about what they say in Washington, D.C. He's a human being. See, that's what they lose sight of. And he hired me, and I did what the scripture said. One day that little guy came by my desk. This is when I found out that God was in the talent distribution business. Yeah, that's another place in redistribution, man. You want the redistribution policy. Look at Matthew 25. He gave 1.5 and gave 1.2 and 1.1. His redistribution plan was not, oh, I feel so sorry for the one that buried it. That's not the point I was making. Even though he called that one wicked and lazy. Took it from him. No, the point I was making is that little white guy came by my desk one day and said, boy, you sure talk a lot. He said, have you ever considered sales and marketing? See, it was a distribution company. company, food distribution company. So when I was debating welfare reform and in front of those senators and stuff, we had to talk about, you know, well, how is this going to impact folks? There was a preacher over here, he was arguing about how, young lady, if we change welfare the way that you're saying, those girls are going to end up at my doorstep. And I turned back and said, well, preacher, don't you think that's a good idea? I mean, we start thinking about it. Then you had others up there saying, well, we can't have those girls work at McDonald's. And I'm going to say, you know, McDonald's wouldn't have hired me because they had cash registers. I wouldn't hire me at that point. I didn't come to food. I didn't even the basement of a food distribution company answering their telephones. I'm glad I didn't know anyone that said don't take any job unless you have a benefit package. And they offer you some extreme wage because it used to be just a minimum, now it's a livable. Whatever. I mean, I don't know if you know what that means, and I didn't know what it meant at that time, and I'm glad. Because I heard in the rule book that said, just do everything heartily as unto the Lord. And I've answered that phone like it's mine. And that little guy came by my desk one day and said, you sure talk a lot. Have you ever considered sales and marketing? And I didn't know what he was talking about. And by the time he explained it to me, I ended up with a degree in marketing. A BS degree. And I knew that if I could sell for him, I could sell for myself, and I went out into my own business. And that's the business that you see in my bio that was destroyed during the 1992 Los Angeles riots. You mentioned that magazine that I started. I started a little magazine because the preacher had also said that we had to stay from sexual activity until we were married. So what we did was we started this little events calendar to be my friends so that we can find some husbands. And we thought that just like we still had the high school mentality, all the cute guys were at the other schools. So we figured if we distributed through all the churches around town, we might actually meet somebody. And had local advertisers, like all the folks that are here. And hopefully the bookstore that's here, the one that made the billboard here for me, the tickets are at the Limestone Stores, will carry my book because I was also supposed to bring books. When I moved to Washington, my secretary didn't go with me, and details are just not my forte. And so, you got books? I'm like, no, hopefully they'll get them there. I got three books out there, and I know they can get two of them over there. I don't know about the third one because it might be out of print. And I started that business. And we're doing all these little event calendars. And then one day somebody didn't like the decision of the courts. And next thing I know, this whole city is burning down that I lived in. So after, what was it like to live to the 1992 Los Angeles riots? Well, when you see riflemen on top of your Baskin and Robbins, you know you got problems. Or the National Guard down at your grocery store. And I knew my business was out of business. But I wasn't going back to welfare. See, God will keep moving, folks. We don't have to answer the question of charity and poverty, this war on poverty. No, God's already nailed poverty to the cross. He'd keep moving you. I wasn't going back to welfare. Because now I could remember depositing more money in a week than the welfare had sent me in a year. And I just continued to move in my life. And one day I got a telephone call for somebody looking for somebody else. They were from a radio station. And that one little town, you may get 1 5, give white people 5. I don't care, I got 1. And I talked that man into getting me on radio. And I'm glad I didn't know those folks in Washington, D.C. to talk about glass ceilings. And well, then it turned to cement. I do a lot of college lectures. Now it's a cement ceiling. And we found out just recently when the gavel changed that it's a marble ceiling. I'm like, we sent too much money to Washington. They got marble ceilings and floors. Marble in my own house. April 15th coming up again. Passing the basket.
God, what I was talking about.
I went into radio for a little while. And, you know, they didn't fire me. I don't have a lot of time, so I can't get into details there. You got to buy my book. I talk about it in my book. Uncle Sam's Plantation is where my biggest part of my story is, or my autobiography. But I wasn't going back to welfare. Now I'm finished a little bit of radio time. And God opened an amazing door for me to go into radio. I mean, it came a point that they wanted me to move to San Francisco from L.A., and I wasn't moving to San Francisco. They finally put that studio in my house. Doing what my little, one little gift that God gave me. Talking. Making all that money. But by the time they fired me, I knew not to go back to welfare. Because now, I'd given away more money in a year than the welfare had sent me this whole 7 years I was in and out. So you want to talk about true charity? We already have experienced true charity. For God so loved the world that he gave. Amen. He gave. So there are three things that we have to do regarding charity. The first thing we have to do is be a witness in our lives. There will come the enemy by blood and lamb and the word of our testimony. How we live is important. We tell our story by the decisions that we make. You want to help people get out of poverty? The first thing to do is be an example of self-government. Because the first step out of poverty is understanding that you have a moral obligation to be self-sufficient and to be responsible with the choices that you make. The top three social crises confronting us as a nation today are rooted in sexual immorality, AIDS, abortion, and the welfare state. We want righteousness to prevail, then it has to start with me. You know, I love your message of abstinence. Celibacy. I'm 50 years old, folks, and you're living a celibate life the rest of your life? No, I'm living a celibate life today. I take no thought for tomorrow. Who knows? I walk out this door and God will send me my husband. Second thing we have to do is we have to be a part. I love this format to introduce you to local people. You change one, you've changed the world. We don't have to go outside to do that. The Lord will put the need right in your life. It's the most amazing thing that people are dealing with difficulties and crises in their own life. When their best friend or their neighbor is going down the street to try to solve some big major problem. And they're putting their house up on the market very quietly because the husband walked out on them. We have to be a part. I hear all the time people, they want to downsize because now they have an empty nest. Downsize. We have a whole lot of people in need. We're putting up maternity homes across this country. Because we have a really big moral question on the table in Washington, D.C. when it comes to life. And we get further and further away from the solution that we need to redeem us as a culture of people, to redeem us to a culture of life. This is not the first time as a nation that we've had a big moral question on the table and the politicians are trying to find a safe route. We had that question in slavery. And I'm telling you that politicians had a whole lot of say, but we had various people doing their jobs, doing their mission work, doing their part. Those politicians were trying to come up with everything. And back up, Joseph Ellis talks about the founding brothers. He has a great way of discussing this story. In this chapter he calls The Silence. Where during the first time that the Congressional Congress came together, I mean, they just thought they were so brilliant. They just made our founding documents, which are brilliant documents, without mentioning the word slavery. That was a great debate. And whew, we did it. Came out. And the first time they meet in their formal session, here comes Ben Franklin with a delegation of abolitionists. And say, remember those documents we just signed? Yeah, it's a great John the Baptist scenario. It may be legal, but it's not lawful. And they were trying to figure out an answer. How are we going to deal with this? Madison got up. All the rest of them got up. I'm not going to tell you that little story. I'm talking about today, our story. But during that time, and it's the same question and same time that we're in, a big moral question. You had others that were doing things. You had Frederick Douglass. Some of you know the names. You had people like Elijah Lovejoy. You know, abolitionist printer. He just kept printing. And they just kept destroying, and finally lost his life over it. Garrison, we know about him. We know about a lot of them. We know Sir Jordan Truth. Oh, how about Harriet Beecher Stowe? We know her. You talk about an icon who will not be in the record of the feminists. I mean, this lady, she accepted the fact that we don't have women preachers. She was in a family with six brothers, all of them preachers. And here's a lone girl. Well, I can't be a preacher. I mean, calling the EOC. We'll talk about this and change the rules. No, she wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin. But we also had you represented. We had Harriet Tubman. We had, while they were trying in Washington to figure out an answer to this big moral question, we had Sister Tubman out there taking one at a time. One at a time. Out of slavery. It's kind of like that story people talk about on the beach to that little ship. What was it, like a little jellyfish or something? Yeah. Starfish? Oh, a star. And they pull the fish and throw it back in. They pull the fish and throw it back in. Now, they better not be on my beach. I'm going to step on it. But I tell you, that's where we got to be apart. have to find our unique parts. And Lord, what can I do in the life of one to change the world? And then the third and final thing we need to do is be steadfast and immovable. Always abounding in his work. I'm telling you, the Lord will continue in individual people's lives that are in need. We're going to continue in Washington to remove the barriers. That's my job. Remove the barriers so people can live free. The answer to poverty is freedom and personal responsibility, not a welfare state. So people can live free. But we have to be steadfast and immovable because God answers all his moral questions. He's going to answer the one in our culture today as well. Gets to the point where he answers them. And in fact, even today, there are hundreds of, you know, actually millions, because you think about it. You think about those Catholics, or you think about the Episcopals and the Lutherans and all the people that still have a liturgical order. Millions of these people, every single day, for hundreds of years, they keep praying, don't let the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, or their hope taken away. Is that right? Where's the first father? That's all I'm over there. Father, is that right? Don't we say, don't let the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, or their hope taken away? Sam, don't we say that every day? Don't let the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, or their hope taken away. But you know what? That is not a prayer in the Psalm 918. It's a statement. And the statement says, the needy will not be forgotten, and their hope won't be taken away. And in my Bible, that statement is on the left page. And on the right page, right across from it, there's a Psalm 12. And in the middle of Psalm 12, there's this little verse. God's response. He said, for the oppression of the poor and for the sighing of the needy. I have to say that word slowly because it's just the most amazing word, sighing. It's such agony and pain. You think about the agony and pain, the demonstration that we saw earlier. We don't think often of Mary's side. I think about it a lot because I buried a 14-year-old. The agony and sighing. He said, I'll be for the oppression of the poor and for the sighing of the needy. Now I'm going to arise, says the Lord. And he says, I'm going to set them in the safety that they yearn for. There's another interesting word in the same passage. Yearning. It's supposed to cry now. HIV virus is running through our house and prosperous across this country like wildfires. These are the new things that we have to talk about in Washington, D.C. Since that's where most think that these answers should come from. Like wildfire, he said, but they're yearning for safety. And he said, I'm going to set them in that place. You know, he sets them in the place here. And, there, and he's done. Because I'm telling you, in the area of charity, I don't think I'm out. That's not their business. Charity is not their business. We each have a role in part. When God established governments, he did establish three of them. Some people say four, but I know at least about three. And the family government's one. That's why it's under attack. It's political too. Can't talk about that. Protecting marriage. Civil government has its part. Church government has its role. You think about poverty, God is going to answer that question. And one day we're not going to have this situation that we have now where we have some big war. We just pool resources, over $400 billion a year, $1 billion a day, less than 20% reaching the household. Not even asking what's happening. And when he does, we won't be able to, when he answers that question, and history records, and your little grandkids get up on your knee and say, you know what, I was reading in history today that such and such and such is what's happening. And then they were happening under your watch. What did you do? You want to be able to start talking to them for some of the things that you did as a decent individual in a little quiet place and having the opportunity to do amazing things for the Lord. Thank you so much for allowing me to share here.
Testimony as we think about moral relativism in our needy world and the agent of change. We all know who's the agent of change, right?
So the challenge before us as we conclude this morning is to know Christ. And if you're saying here this morning, I'm not certain. Maybe you haven't crossed that line of faith. Maybe today, starting today, this Good Friday, you'd like to start a whole new life in Christ. If you'd like to do that, I'd ask you to have the courage to come up and talk to myself or anyone here up at this head table. We'd like to have the opportunity to talk with you and share with you if you're not sure that if you were to die today, that you're going to go to heaven. So as we conclude this morning, the challenge as believers in Christ is to live our lives in love for each other, in preparation for eternity, and in confidence that Christ died for each one of us and that our lives have more meaning as a result of what happened on the cross 2,000 years ago, an event that changed the world forever. So thank you for being here this morning. A reminder that the flowers go home with the person who has a birthday closest to today. Please don't take the vase. That's the hotels. So leave that behind. I'd like to have Bob Klaus stand and be recognized at this time for all his hard work and his team. Stand up, Bob. I'm going to ask Pastor Aaron Telecki from Maranatha Bible Church to dismiss us with a word of prayer.
Let's bow together. Father, I'm mindful of the fact as we draw this time to a close this morning that it was at this very hour, on this very day, 2,000 years ago, when the King of Glory was being nailed to his cross. And the reason we call this day good, Father, is because of who Jesus Christ is. And the reason we call this day good is because of what Jesus Christ did. And the reason we call this day good is because He bore the penalty so that we could be free. Father, I'm also mindful of the fact that on the night before He died, Jesus sat down, and just as we've heard here, He looked His disciples squarely in the eye, and He says, "As I have loved you, love one another." And Father, the message, I believe, is really just that simple. If we're to take anything with us today, first may it be the gospel, as Carl has just said. But from that point, having the gospel, having Christ, the Savior, at the center of our lives, the message really is that simple. Go and do to others as I have done for you, sacrificially, with joy, with truth, with grace and freedom. And take the love of Jesus Christ to one and then another and another one after that. Father, I praise You for the challenge we've had this morning. Praise You for the conviction that You've brought to my heart, to the heart of so many here. Father, I pray that we leave with Jesus Christ, with our eyes firmly fixed on Him, and with the determination to do whatever He calls us to do, to go wherever He calls us to go, to serve however He calls us to serve for Your glory. In Jesus' name.
Thank you again for being here this morning. Bobby Calhoun is going to sing for us as you leave today. Have a great day and happy Easter.